Future trends, deep insights, industry leaders. This is the iGaming Next podcast with your host, Pierre Lindh.
Mads, it's nice to be acquainted with you here. Nice to meet you today, obviously the CEO of Lady Luck. And how are things going in general today?
Yeah, first of all, thank you for having me here. I'm looking super forward to this podcast. Yeah, things are good. Been a busy year, you can say. So a lot is going on.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So obviously, I've been following Lady Luck games for a while. It's one of my best friends, Kenny, obviously, who works for you guys and who got in touch with us to do this podcast in the first place. So it'd be interesting to follow, you know, his journey in the company recently. But I know that you guys were just founded in around 2 years ago, 2019. And since then, you have publicly listed the company, you know, and since the public listing early in the year, it's been growing steady at a steady pace. But can you just, as a starting point, introduce Lady Luck Games and your journey so far?
Absolutely. You are totally right. We were founded in just around January 2019 by a guy called Rasmus Kær, that we will come back to a bit, and myself. We founded the company because we basically thought we could do it a bit better. We were getting a bit tired of seeing the same graphic in all the games, the same quality of graphic. And when you hear a little more about Rasmus's background a little later here, then you will know exactly why, because he is the original founder of the video game Hitman and has been doing big game productions for decades of years. He made with the Hitman 7 blockbuster games, 2 Hollywood movies, and yeah, sold millions and millions of copies. So he have gaming in his heart and come from that world. And we could just together see that there was a business possibility in founding a new game studio. Rasmus wanted to jump into more rapid game development. I mean, a Hitman production was typical plus 5 years before it went to the market, and he wanted to move into faster games, faster productions, where you also get faster feedback. So we saw a business possibility in that and jumped into it, basically. Yeah.
Yeah, interesting.
One thing that we explored at once was that for us it was critical to get the right technical team from day one. I mean, as you see, many game studios out there are starting up now, have been starting up, are using a lot of consultancies and outsourcing a lot. We have done it a little differently. We have, from day one, had our own team, our own technical foundation, you can say, with our friends and employees in Riga and Latvia. We have created an extremely strong team. So that helped us a lot in the beginning. I mean, the guys, Vadim and Rudolf, that we founded the company with, they knew exactly from day one what we were going to do. So with their long background in the gambling industry, they knew exactly how to build the RGS, knew exactly how to make the appealing APIs so we could integrate our games really fast into operators and aggregators and so on. So when we took the decision to found the company, we were pretty fast in production, you can say. Mm-hmm. So, and that gave us the first game after 6-7 months. And then we have been able, or were able, to produce basically a game per month afterwards. So
Yeah, fast-paced, in other words.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. And we spoke a little bit here before that we are indirectly business partners here, because you obviously recently acquired the game studio Spigo.
Yes.
Which is run, it used to be run by Kasper Kau, who's a good friend of both of us, I guess. And a couple of years ago, we have this concept that's called Showers. It's a big pool party and whatever. And Kasper was a big fan of this concept and decided to create a slot game based on our concept, based on our IP, which is now in your hands. So I congratulate you to a fantastic acquisition here, of course, and particularly to the great IP of Showers here.
But thank you.
But how did it come to be the acquisition of Spigo?
During discussions with Ladylock, I mean, since both Rasmus and me are Danish, one of the big operators that we really want to get a connection to and to learn from was, of course, Danske Spil, based in Denmark. So by contacting them, by having meeting with them, we realized that the fastest way to get our games live in their network was to integrate via Kasper Kau and Spigo and their platform. And in all that, we just realized, hey, why don't we just buy them? So we own our own distribution instead of making an complicated agreements. Mm-hmm. And Kasper wanted something more for his studio. He has been with his former partners for 6, 7, 8 years, but really wanted to do something now, wanted to go more international, and all that fit totally perfect into Ladylock strategy. So we bought all the B2B asset out of Spigo, and Kasper also and his team, and they are now a part of Ladylock. So yeah, that is super cool.
Yeah, great. Kasper obviously has a great experience, and he's super intelligent. I mean, great asset to have on the team as well. I want to take a step back here as well, and go back to the listing that you did earlier in the year. Now, it's quite interesting because you were very early in the journey in the organization, and usually my perception at least is when a company lists itself is usually when the strategy is really solidified and the company really knows where it's going and so on. And so I found it quite interesting that you were listing the company publicly this early in the company's journey. Can you talk about how did it come about to list the company public, what challenges is there in general of running a kind of a startup in a public environment?
Yeah, absolutely. As I said, we started the company there January 2019, funded it by own pockets from me and Rasmus. So, you know, during the time, after 1 year, we have grown quite a lot, both in terms of employees, in terms of cost and so on. During summer 2020, we saw that there were two roads for us. Either we get external capital attracted into the company, or we had to slow down a bit because it was really getting costful. But we saw and discussed with our advisors that the opportunity was there for going directly for a listing. Mm-hmm. And you could say it's really in early stage, and it was super early stage. I mean, at that time, the company hadn't really had any revenue yet. Mm-hmm. That was building up. We were building the foundation and have also used 2021 to build the foundation for the company for future growth. So nothing was really in place. But the reason that we want to do it and did it was we saw a perfect strategy for it. I mean, we see now that there's a big market or a big opportunity to follow the big guys in the business. Evolution Gaming have bought Net, and Big Time Gaming created a huge company. But now there's a room for smaller studios like us also to build a bigger body. And we saw that pretty early during summer last year that is our goal in this business. That is what we want to do. We want to be the catalysator for M&A activities between smaller mid-size studios, and we think there's a huge market for that.
Right. So your intention is to grow through M&A.
Both organic, of course, but organic is not enough for our appetite. We want more speed, and then it's definitely M&A. And there's also another reason for doing a lot of M&A activities. I mean, it's all about getting creative brains into the company, right? I mean, we are nothing more than our employees. That is the one that are creating Ladylock games. So we need all the time to have the best employees with the brightest brains that can create new, fantastic content for the industry.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned, like, right now you are something like 25 employees or somewhere around there.
Still small, yeah.
Yeah, but as we were saying before the recording here, you know, when Big Time Gaming was sold to NetEnt, they were a football team.
Yeah,
so there were 11 people.
Exactly.
What was that? How much were they sold for, like 90 million euros or something? I mean...
a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the size is not a goal for us. The goal is to create fantastic content that our customers cannot live without.
Yeah. And it's an interesting question, though, because when Big Time Gaming was sold to Evolution, I think the valuation was roughly, I can't remember exactly, a third or a fourth or something like that of NetEnt's. When they were acquired by Evolution. But if you look at the number of staff, NetEnt had something like, you know, 700 staff, and Big Ten Gaming had a football team, 11 people.
Yeah.
How do you see the growth in Ladylock? Is there a pros and cons to either of those two directions? Do you see yourself growing exponentially and having these like major teams like NetEnt did in their strategy, or do you see yourself just focusing on the content and that's it, like Big Time Gaming?
We haven't really decided if we are going to grow the team to a big team. That needs to come naturally by driven by sales and revenue and so on. Our ambition is to provide fantastic content. If it takes 30 or 300 employees, I mean, that depends. Let's see how it will develop. As I said, the goal itself is not to create a huge organization. The goal is to really make this special content that will make a very profitable company.
Yeah,
that is what we have promised our shareholders, and that is what we want to do.
Yeah. And it's interesting here, like you mentioned, your co-founder Rasmus, obviously he comes from a different angle here, right? And that is, to me, it seems after the conversation that is the strength and the asset that you have in this organization, is the fact that you have an art director who doesn't necessarily come from the same background as the competition's design team and art directors and so on. He comes from, you know, the hardcore gaming, video gaming world, with like world-class experience behind him, and that's what he's bringing to the table here. Is this coming from a different angle? Is that correct?
Yeah, totally. And if you see around in our organization, you will see that the bits and pieces that we have picked up are actually really known people in the gaming industry and gambling industry as well. Our chairman, Pierre Eriksson, former CEO from NetEnt. For a small company like ours to get the possibility to work with a guy like that, that is just incredible and shows me that we are doing something interesting for the business.
Yeah,
we have extremely skilled developers that have been with Skywind Group for years and years and creating a lot of video slots for them. Mm. So if you see in the organization, the bits and pieces are the creative brains and the knowledge, business knowledge that we have.
Yeah. And you know, we spoke here a little bit before. You mentioned Evolution here and the standing they have in the industry. And is it true that the opportunity here is now that many operators, they don't want to be committed, let's say, to or being at the mercy to one supplier? They want diversity in the supply chain, essentially. Can you talk a bit more about that? Like, what's the feedback you have from operators in general?
It is a little old phrase, but content is king. That is how it is. And the operators need more and more and better content. You cannot get that from one single supplier. It's impossible. Everyone knows that. You need the creativity from different angles. And you only get that with having multiple suppliers. So everyone is talking about these big companies are creating some sort of monopoly towards the supply chain to the operators. I see it totally the opposite. I see it as a huge opportunity for smaller studios like ours. If we deliver good quality, that's all what it's about, super good quality, then there for sure is a huge market for us as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is what I hear in general as well from operators, is that they don't want to be at the mercy of one supplier. Like, they want to have the mercy, because if something happens with that one supplier, then it's increasing your risk profile in the organization if you are standing and falling on one supplier, essentially.
Yeah, and you don't get enough input. I mean, one supplier cannot cover it all. There will be us, there will be others out there that are doing amazing stuff that you cannot live without. So I think no one wants one supply. No. That's not the trend at all.
And so it'd be interesting to hear more about this. We mentioned here before on the growing through M&A, and obviously you already acquired Spigo, so you have already proven that you can do M&A, obviously, and in this stage of your organization. What would you say is the long-term goal for the organization? Do you see yourself becoming potentially one of the top tier game studios eventually, or what type of ambitions do you have in general?
We absolutely aim for becoming a big company in this sector. Absolutely. I mean, otherwise we wouldn't have chosen the listed road for the company. Then we would have chosen a non-listed road, I think. But the listed road is absolutely an ambition to grow, and to grow a lot. And as we have been talking about, the only way to grow fast enough is via M&A. Yeah. And not even the growth, but also that you want to buy in different geniuses that are sitting out there in smaller companies at the moment.
Yeah, fair enough. And speaking about being listed and versus not being listed, like you have experience, obviously, Mads, in a host of listed companies in your career and so on. Like, what's the pros and cons of running a listed public company?
There are many of both, I will say, but if you take the pros of being a listed company, I mean, for a small company like us, we got a valid currency that we can pay with when we are making M&A activities, our own share, because we now have a listed share that are worth something that you actually can trade, where you can put a price on every day, every minute. That's a big pro and the main reason for being a listed company as ours. You have a different access to capital. Some will say easier, some will say much harder, but at least you have this regulated access to capital if you want to grow in the future. That are definitely the big pros. On the con side, I mean, of course, you need to report everything, right? you have a big organization built around finance reporting, investor relation. You need to report everything exactly at same time to everyone. I mean, we cannot have shareholders running around having different information. So that is one of the big things with being a listed company, right? That you have to have this super huge instrument behind you all the time to deliver the financial reports, to deliver press releases, to be in contact with shareholders, answer shareholders. But do not get too much information that already have been published.
Yeah, exactly. And I just finished a book called The Power Play, which is the history of Tesla, basically from the foundation to where it is today, obviously run by Elon Musk. And through the book, Elon Musk talks a lot about the pros and cons, let's say, of being a listed company as Tesla is. And in his case, considering that he's a very controversial figure and he does a lot of controversial things and he wants to be mobile and change the strategy and do something crazy and so on, he talks a lot about how he feels handcuffed sometimes being a listed company. Is it? Do you feel that sometimes as well? Like you have to kind of choose a strategy, and it's very difficult to move from that strategy when you are listed?
No, not at all. I think with the Elon Musk, his company was, and his whole person is maybe not to a listed environment. I think he's too much a cowboy to be involved in that. I think it's not difficult in any way. You just need to follow the rules and be really strict about what you're doing. Yeah. Then it's a perfect road for a company like ours, and especially in a company in this sector, mm-hmm. where you have high growth rates, and it's a good environment to be in. Yeah. It's not handcuffed in any way.
No. Okay, that is interesting. Interesting to hear, and I guess in our sector as well. I mean, your game studio, of course, and your idea is to build an excellent organization producing really great games. So it's not like you cannot divert too much from that strategy anyway. Like it's quite obvious what the strategy is, so to say. It's quite straightforward what it is that you need to do.
Yeah.
To be successful in this industry, unless you decide from one day to the other to turn into an operator, which doesn't really make much sense, right?
No, it wouldn't really make sense, and it would be such a big change that we would probably have to ask our shareholders before doing it. And that is not at all in our strategy. Our strategy is to continue build content supply. It could be with the video slots as we are doing now with our casual video or our casual games that we bought from Spigo, but it could also be something third. But everything will be centralized about the content supplying.
Fair enough. And what would you say, Nomads, as well? I mean, in the young stage that you are in the company, just establishing yourself with the operators and so on, what's the biggest challenges of building this organization now?
Right now, I think for us, the biggest challenge is to get fast enough distribution.
Right. Distribution is the key.
That is absolutely the key. You can have the best content, the best games in the world, but if you don't have your supply chain working, then then it's hard. Yeah. And we took some huge step by our partnership with Everymetrix, that led us into 100 of operators in just one integration, and has been actually working really well for us.
Yeah, right. And so now the hurdle is basically being able to sign as many agreements as possible with operators. Yeah. That's pretty much the challenge.
Absolutely.
And when you talk to operators, it's quite straightforward these days, right? As an operator, like many operators are hungry for good content. It's not like back in the day where you only had two game studios, game suppliers or whatever, partner with operators, and they were kind of handcuffed with them. What's the feedback you're getting in general when you talk to operators as a new game studio?
I think the biggest challenge is to come on their list for prioritizing new integrations. I think everyone have a long waiting list for technical integration, so... We, of course, also want to look into how can we do it faster, how can we do it easier, and especially there, our cooperation with Everymetrix help us a lot. They have a good tech team for the integration, and they can do it fast, smooth, and it's working really well.
Yeah.
So that is one of the challenges. And when it comes to the opportunities with going into operators, I mean, the feedback we are getting is that we do have amazing looking games that are working really well. So I think that is where we have put us in the business, in the space. We have taken that space that we really create fantastic graphic in our games.
Yeah.
And as you know, it's like buying a new car or buying something else. It's the first impression that is the most important, and it is for players as well. I mean, you cannot come to the market with something that are not so nice to look at. It needs to have some appealing in front of the player, so they really want to try the game.
Yeah.
And when they have tried the game, then the gameplay needs to be good enough so they stay there, of course.
Yeah,
but the first is the impression, the first time impression. And I think we are really good at that.
Cool. Yeah, what does it take to make like a hit game? Because this is kind of like the holy grail. I mean,
yeah, exactly.
It's an impossible question. No? Like, but someone like Ras, you know, I mean, how do you create this hit? Because if you look back on the game studios that have popped up and become successful, it always seems like there is like struggle in the beginning. They release games, they are maybe not so popular, and then after a while there's like one hit that really elevates the game studio to the next level, so to say. And we talked about before Fnet and type of Starburst, for example, and there's other example, Big Time Gaming, there was the Mega Waves, of course, which was not a game, it was a game mechanic. But can you talk about this as well, like what's the best way to increase your chances to create a really popular game?
That's a super good question.
Yeah. I'm asking for all your trade secrets here now.
I have, you know, at the moment I have 25 people looking into that each day. How can we make the new big hit?
Yeah. Well, if I may give you a suggestion here, you have the Showers IP already, so it's already served on a silver plate here for you.
Exactly. But anyway. No, I think, you know, you need to have the creative brains that really can look into what would a player find amusing here. You know, how can you amuse, how can you entertain the players? And then you need the math behind the game to be extremely good, well working. You need a fantastic graphic at all to get the players to try the game.
Yeah.
Will it be a hit or not? The thing is, you don't really know it before you put it out in its life. I mean, there you get the feedback at once. Either it will fly or not, or it will be a middle game. And you don't really know it.
Yeah.
And no one have the recipe for making a good game. I mean, then it would be done every week or every month. It's like computer games that you don't know really what will hit and what the people will adopt. We are all trying our best all the time.
Finding
new ways. I think it's there are so many games produced, so many games getting live each month that you also need to stick out a bit, try new design, try new math, try new gameplay. Our newest game that are coming out is one row game. That is totally new to the market, and I look forward to see how that will be adopted.
Exciting. So Mats, to start round off a little bit here now, like, what would you say is the investment case for Ladylike Games?
But we are typical high growth. Yeah, I mean, you should invest in Ladylock games if you want to be a part of the journey. That is simply, and believe in the journey. I mean, you need to believe in what we are doing and want to be a part of that. We think we have built the foundation for a really good growth case here in the future.
Yeah.
We have used 3 years now to build the foundation technically, to be, build it financially, to set up the right people, the right methods, so we can easily adopt new M&A objectives. We can easily take over new companies. We know exactly how we are going to implement the team in our existing team. We know how we are going to implement the financial, the technical part, all that. So I think we are ready. We are there.
Yeah, super interesting. And obviously we're here in Malta now doing this recording together, and you are exhibiting tomorrow at Sigma, right? This will be the first exhibition that you do?
Yeah, it is.
Oh, so exciting.
On a small booth, but yeah, let's see. We look forward to the feedback to get the visit from a lot of partners, friends and customers. So that will be super exciting the next days. Absolutely.
Well, you'll absolutely see me. You'll absolutely see me at the booth then tomorrow. We'll have let's say a glass of coffee tomorrow or something like that, then at the exhibition.
Thank you so much.
All right. Brilliant, Mats. Any last words from your end? If you want to invest in Lidlack, you're listed in on First North.
NASDAQ Stockholm. Yes.
Yeah. Exactly.
So.
Brilliant. So let's follow up there. I'm sure in a couple of years we'll have this discussion again, and then
the horizon
will be a lot wider. But it's super interesting, Mats, to get an insight into the smaller game studios as well now that are opening up with some big visions here, of course, as well. Oftentimes in this podcast, we talk to some of the biggest studios and on a bigger scale. But it's really interesting to hear the perspective from a smaller studio who now have the ambition to grow. So thank you for coming on today and sharing.
Thank you for having me. Thanks. Brilliant.
All right, let's go have another coffee together.
Absolutely.
Cheers. Thank you, Mats.
Cheers.
Brilliant.